This video is sponsored by Established Titles. You know you don't have long. A timer has started ticking, counting down the minutes until you die of oxygen deprivation. Surrounded by pitch darkness, you struggle to move your arms and legs. Trapped under a blanket of snow that has just broken away from the mountain, you can feel your hot breath filling the tiny air pocket you've found yourself in. It was just a backcountry skiing trip. You'd never imagined you'd end up imprisoned under the snow. Your mind flashes through everything you could have done better and everything you did wrong. All the while, the time continues tick, tick, ticking down to zero. And with that out of the way, let's get into it.
I present to thee Lord Grillburns!
I brew you all hermit. Gather the heat and snacks. Tonight, we feast and celebrate my new title.
Oh, neat costume.
Costume? Bah, this is who I'm dressing for now on. I'm a lord now. Copies. Chill. My dear boy, this is the best Valentine's gift ever.
Okay, explain.
Thanks to today's sponsor, Established Titles, my boo's a genuine lord now. Check it out.
Oh, goodness.
By purchasing as little as 1 square of dedicated land on a private estate in Ardeley, Aberdeenshire, or Scotland, you, a friend or a loved one, can officially become a lord or lady. In an effort to help preserve the breathtaking woodlands, biodiversity, and overall good vibes of Scotland, Established Titles use that land to plant a tree for each order. They also support global charities like One Tree Planted and Trees for the Future to help with their afforestation efforts. Plus, they'll even give you a plot number so you can check out the exact location of your land.
So, Grill gets his legitimate title.
Aye.
And his land is used to fund charitable organizations committed to helping the environment and preserve the beautiful landscapes of Scotland?
Aye.
Alright, I'm sold. This really is a victory for everyone.
Looking for a last-minute Valentine's gift to surprise your boo? Established Titles is having a lovely promotion to celebrate Valentine's Day. Head on over to establishedtitles.com/brew and use promo code BREW to get 10% off any purchase you make.
Do it, you cowards.
With the first flurries of snow falling this winter, you and a few of your friends get an idea to go backcountry skiing outside of town. You check the forecast, and a fresh snowfall bodes well for the slope conditions. The snow flies around you as you cut through the thick snow. Your friend Brad, who is more experienced, speeds up ahead, slicing between the trees. He does a little jump off a bump, and as he lands, a low woomph booms through your chest, and a crack shoots through the snow. You call out to him, but realize it's too late. A sheet of snow breaks away, carrying him further down the mountain. Rumbling as it goes, you feel the ground give way below your feet as well, and before you know it, you're tumbling down the mountain behind him. All avalanches typically have three parts: a starting zone where the snow breaks away, a track that guides the course of the avalanche, and a runout where the snow and debris will settle. In these situations, the safest place to be is out of the path of the avalanche. If you see one coming, move perpendicular to its course. If one starts just below your own feet, like just now, then try to leap upslope above the fracture line. Avalanches typically pick up speed as they move, like any object responding to gravity. So the worst places to be are inside the avalanche and in its way. You're either being tossed around in a truckload of rocks, trees, and chunks of ice, or someone is throwing a truckload of trees, rocks, and chunks of ice at you. Generally, avalanches have natural triggers, like a falling tree, a change in the weather, or a human being jumping around. Unlike what movies would have you believe, avalanches are almost never triggered by loud noises. They also come in two different forms, sloughs and slabs. Sloughs are giant landslides of loose powdery snow that move rapidly down a slope in a V-shape, whereas slabs are huge chunks of denser snow that slide down a mountainside. The woomph you just heard was the sound of a slab breaking away. You can think of a slough avalanche like sand falling down a dune. It's less dangerous, but depending on the mass, it can still damage property and bury individuals, though. Slabs are dangerous because, as the name suggests, the slabs of snow contain much higher mass and are significantly denser, resulting in far more potential damage. Where an avalanche will settle is determined by what is called an alpha angle, or an angle of reach. A line is drawn between the trigger location of an avalanche and the historical runout of previous avalanches. It's quite complicated, but experts use a lot of math to figure out the safest place to build and allow people to visit. When you go in for any winter sports, especially alpine ones, knowing all warning signs of danger is a must. Seeing an avalanche is obviously a giant warning sign that danger is near, but cracks in the snow and hollow sounds below the surface are also common signs that one is forming. Not only that, fresh snowfall, warming temperatures, and high winds also increase the risk of avalanches. The risk level is codified on a scale of 1 to 5 by the North American Public Avalanche Scale, ranging from low to extreme. Ski teams figure this out by measuring how densely the snow is packed. The better bonded the snow, the lower the scale. Both Canada and the United States use handy maps with all ski resorts and their respective scale value next to them to make it as easy as possible for you. Generally, ski hills and alpine resorts employ experts that identify possible avalanche routes and regularly test those routes in lab settings. For example, the denser the snow, the higher the chance of avalanche. Safety teams will take a portion of snow, melt it, then weigh the water to check the density. They will also take the temperature of the snow as it sits on the mountain to see what kind of ice has formed, because different sized and shaped ice crystals will either notch in with each other or slide apart. Teams will also reference the avalanche observation and reference card to note specific phenomena and the connected avalanche risk. You should always check the risk before you head out. Experts create these systems to keep you safe and make them as accessible as possible. You should always have an operating avalanche transceiver that ski patrols can use to find you electronically before going out for winter sports, off-piste or on. If you're lost or trapped under the snow, you may not have the elbow room to get it operational. You begin to panic as the tide of snow hauls you down the mountainside. Brad disappears over a small ridge, but when you tumble over the side, he's nowhere to be seen. You reach out to try and grab a tree or anything, but they slip out from between your fingers. Grabbing something sturdy will hopefully drag you out of the path. However, in major avalanches, the weight of the massive snow will destroy anything in its path, so trees and boulders will likely be swept away as well. It's of paramount importance to keep your head over the surface of the snow. We all know that snow is just frozen water, but interestingly enough, it doesn't need to melt to start acting like a liquid again. If you're caught in an avalanche, tread water like you're swimming to keep your head above the surface. You feel a force tugging down on you, threatening to sink you below the surface. You kick hard and try to stay afloat, but you can still feel yourself being pulled downward. Brad is a few meters ahead, and you can see the glint of his goggles reflecting the sun. You try to signal him, but he too is struggling to stay above the surface. You can see that he has one hand over his mouth and another stuck straight up in the air. Even in the wild race down the mountain, you manage to copy his movements. You cover your mouth with your hand and stretch your other hand as high above your head as you possibly can before you feel a terrible slam and everything goes dark. Moments later, you open your eyes. You can see a little light refracting through the snow. You think to yourself, "Thank God I covered my mouth." As the snow has become hard packed around your face, suffocation is the number one killer for those trapped in avalanches. Covering your mouth, creating any kind of air pocket around you, and controlling your breathing will make sure that people have as much time to find you as possible. As you calm down, you try to wiggle your fingers, poking and prodding around for some room. Then you try each of your limbs, but to no avail. It occurs to you that you don't even know what direction you're facing. You clear a little more room around your mouth and spit. Your saliva flies out and upward. Oh no, you think. You're upside down. The best thing you can do in this situation is remain calm. Again, the biggest danger of being trapped in snowfall is suffocation, and panicking will only deplete your oxygen supply faster. In the same vein, shouting for help won't help you, unless you know for a fact that someone is nearby. In the dark, you wait. Your mind flickers to Brad, who must be buried somewhere nearby as well. You think that if your other friends are trapped too, no one might be coming. Then you remember the transceiver. You know that it's on. You made sure that it was transmitting before you left. You close your eyes, try to keep breathing slowly, and think about rescue. After what feels like an eternity, you hear something. You start to call out and shift your legs in the tiny space, hoping that someone might notice you. You hear the sounds grow closer, closer, before they seemingly disappear. Losing hope, you keep screaming and kicking as hard as you can. You start to panic. It's hard, but it's of the utmost importance that you remain calm. Again, the most dangerous thing for someone trapped in an avalanche is suffocation. If you hear people nearby, you should try to call out to them, but make sure you maintain a steady breath. Your mind continues barreling down the tracks. What if someone was up there, but they didn't hear you? How long have you been buried? Are you running out of oxygen? Is it getting even tighter in here? Your mind is racing. Your breathing grows faster, shallower, until you feel a poking on your backside. Suddenly, a thin shaft pierces through the snow in front of you. You hear more voices above, as well as what sounds like a dog. And, like a miracle, you see hands digging through the snow. Moments later, you can feel someone grabbing you by your legs, and you're tugged out of your snowy prison cell. You emerge into the bright sun, blinking as your eyes adjust to the dazzling rays reflecting off the snow. Rescue personnel wrap you up in a thermal blanket, and you relish the much-needed warmth. You scan back and forth, looking for Brad in the rubble. He's nowhere to be seen. You tell the rescuers that someone else is lost nearby, and they reassure you that they'll keep looking. One of the first responders tells you that you were smart for keeping your transceiver on your person. Without it, they would have taken much longer to find you. Avalanche transceivers are one of the best tools for ski rescues, sending out a 457 kHz radio signal that rescuers can search for within 80 meters. In addition to that, rescuers also use the RECCO system, which consists of a detector and reflector. A skier or mountaineer can wear a reflector, and the detector sends out radio signals, which are reflected back to be detected. They work very similarly to avalanche transceivers. However, their distance is limited, so they're often used in conjunction with other technologies. You express worry for your friends because you lost them almost instantly in the fall. But patrollers direct your attention to the rescue dog they brought along with them. Rescue dogs are a great help to ski patrollers because of their keen sense of smell. Trained to use the scent of sweat and panic pheromones under the snow, a trained rescue dog can cover 2.5 acres 8 times faster than 20 humans could. Lastly, rescuers carry collapsible probes to pinpoint the exact location of any victims. Transceivers, RECCO reflectors, and even rescue dogs are great at pointing patrollers to the right area. But when it comes to finding someone, there's nothing better than a very long stick. It's not as simple as just poking around willy-nilly, however. There are specific patterns that patrollers follow to ensure that they don't miss anything. Then, they actually dig you out, which can be the simplest part of avalanche rescue operations, depending on the conditions. But the most important factor is how long it takes them to find you, due to limited oxygen supply. If you're not found immediately, your live rescue operation will quickly become a body recovery mission. You keep waiting, but still, Brad hasn't been found. You ask the rescuers how long it's been, and they tell you that it's been about half an hour. You continue, asking how long your friend has, and they tell you that, statistically, 93% of victims are recovered alive if found within 15 minutes. But after 45 minutes, that number drops to as low as 20%. After 2 hours, the odds of finding victims alive is nearly zero. You're strapped onto a stretcher and carried down the mountain and back to the resort where you're handed off to paramedics. You see your other friends as you pass, and they ask about Brad. You tell them that you don't know where he is, before you're loaded into the ambulance and whisked away to the hospital. You're checked over for injuries and frostbite at the hospital, but thankfully, you're okay. The cold wasn't given enough time to get into hypothermia, and luckily, snow is a surprisingly good insulator. You ask about Brad again, and your doctor, with a grave expression, informs you that he was brought in moments ago, but rescuers weren't able to reach him in time. It had been over an hour before he was found, and by the time they were able to dig him out, he was already lost. In the end, it was the joint effort of some good technology and the quick response of ski rescue teams, not to mention a healthy dose of dumb luck, that saved your life. But if you want to make sure that your well-being is never left up to chance, follow guidelines laid out by your local authority, do your research, and make sure you have the right equipment. That way, you can be sure that you're as far away from at-risk areas as possible. Because the best way to survive an avalanche is to be far, far away from them.